Let's call to order, please, the Board of Directors meeting for the IRL Council of January the 8th, approximately 9:40, and we're in new facilities, and we're just pleased and delighted for these facilities, and we appreciate so much the city making this available. Thank you. Let's stand, please, for pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. Do we have any revisions for the agenda? Anyone wish to make additions to the agenda? I see none. We have approval. We need a motion for approval of the agenda, please. Moved. Second.
Second.
Any other discussion? Any wish to vote no? That's accepted unanimously. The minutes, as they were provided, as they were emailed out to everyone, anyone have corrections, additions to the minutes? I see none. Can we have a motion to accept the minutes
as
they were provided? Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Anyone wish to vote no? Those are accepted unanimously. We do have public here, and there may be public that would wish to make comment. And if so, please, you would come to the lectern and follow all of those directions about approximately. I'm already violating. So it's already broken in. The system's already broken in. So you don't need to feel, it's not delicate. And come to the lectern and you'll be received. Anyone wish to make comment from the public, please? I see none. We will be going to item number five, the status of transition from St. John's to council. Ms. Ansi, and yes?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
This is my first time with this microphone, so I apologize if I'm too loud. Just wanted to briefly give you an update on where we are with the transfer. As you may recall, last month we had indicated to you that we were waiting for final word from EPA that indeed the grant had been transferred over to the IRL Council from the St. John's River Water Management District. And I'm pleased to report that we received word, and Jennifer can fill in some of the greater details, but basically we did receive word that the IRL Council is now officially the named grantee. There are, I believe, in if anything's changed since our last communication, some additional things that need to happen with OMB to leave those funds or open those funds up. So I'll turn it over to Jennifer to fill you in.
Okay. Well, I am pleased to report that the IRL Council is the official host of the Indian River Lagoon National Estuary Program. The cooperative agreement between EPA and the IRL Council has been finalized. The grant, as well as the funds, have been loaded into IRL Council's account. And we just got word last night that those funds are now available. So, congratulations.
Wow.
The loop has been closed.
I think we need to recognize that you're diligent. Pursuit and efforts really made this most timely. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Yes, ma'am.
Just to wrap up the item, basically we're working now on some final mechanics with the Water Management District. We had executed the assignment. They've executed the assignment and delivered it back to us so that the contracts that they had previously entered into through the work plan are now officially contracts of the IRL Council. So there's a few minor cleanup issues we're going through, but basically at this point, we're up and running.
We're alive and well.
Yeah.
It was a good year.
Mr. Chairman?
Good, please. Yes.
I have to inject here. A lot of people told me when I first took this job that this would never happen. And even in the first year, the idea that less than a year ago, the council didn't exist. And in 11 months, with your due diligence and the support of the Water Management District staffs, Carolyn, EPA, that was a yeoman's lift where everybody said, let's not get bureaucratic, let's make it happen. And so I want to personally congratulate you for the vision, but also staff, because it was staff who made it happen. I came in on the back end, and the fact is, a lot of people said this was an impossible task to make that transition in a year, and you did it in 11 months. So I want to thank you for your efforts, but also staff. You guys have done an amazing job. I've watched Frank. I've never seen so many emails between Frank and Jennifer, you know, in 5-minute increments. There were a lot of moving parts, and they stayed at it, and we're all very pleased. So thank you.
I think duly noted, Ms. Ansi, I believe, performed some miraculous events as well. And so I deeply appreciate her focus and ability. So, but your comments are well noted. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Are we ready? You ready to go to six to management conference board updates?
As you recall, over the last several meetings, we've been working on establishing the management conference. We started with the management board at our last meeting, and we are still in that process. So I want to give you an update of where we are on the management board appointments. We have some action items there, and then talk about the next steps with both the STEM AC, Citizens AC, and Finance AC, and we'll take these one item at a time. This is the current status of our management board. I'm pleased to report that we had very positive responses on the invitations that you set out. So before you, you see a spreadsheet. We still have 3 open appointments, and we still have 1 or 2 appointments that are in discussion that are likely to be actionable items at our next meeting. And so what I'd like to do first is just go through the appointments that you will look at today and then make a decision on finalizing those individuals on the board and give you an update on where we stand on some of the others. So Dr. Anthony Katniss, Barbara Lewinsky from DEO, Mark Crosley. I am still working on Department of Health, and I want some guidance, and I'll ask you a question in a minute on that, whether we want to go state, local, or maybe both. Lane Hamilton, Merritt Island National Wildlife Refuge. Robert Muzzer, which actually is an interesting story. When I approached the Port Canaveral, their environmental person had left, and in fact, they were hiring a new individual who, by the time I got to the parking lot, was calling me from South Florida. He was listening to the meeting, and Mr. Muzzer, I think he started this week at the port, but he worked on the management board at the Tampa Bay NEP. And he's super keen on working with us, and he actually knew everything you had done this year. He had been tracking this NEP, and so he's going to be a very interesting and knowledgeable addition, having come from Tampa Bay NEP. Lynn Phillips from NASA. I am still in conversation with Colonel Kirk at Corps of Engineers. I've extended the invitation. He wanted to get back to me after the first of the year. My guess is he's probably checking with Chain of Command, although he didn't say that. But either way, he was very supportive of what we're doing and interested in how we move forward. And then Kristen Niefel. And so the first action will be to if you so choose to accept these individuals as part of the management board formally, and there's one additional point to this one. One of these, Kristen Niefel from National Park Service, will be a contingent addition. There is a memorandum of understanding in your packages. We've modified it slightly just to be a little more specific. She cannot serve until that goes through due process. There's nothing in there that is objectionable, but it is a process that Park Service has, and so her addition would be contingent on execution of the MOU, and so I'm also looking for your direction to go ahead and sign that. We'll move it forward. So that's action item number one.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move that we approve and adopt the additional management board members.
Moved. Second, please.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there other discussion on this? Is there any comment from public on this? I hear none. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any that wish to vote no on that item? That's accepted unanimously. Thank you very much.
And with that, I know we have a number of management board individuals now in the audience, and I'd just like to have them stand so we can recognize them and just thank them for their willingness to volunteer.
Yes,
so would you please stand, those of you who have been appointed to the management board? We won't go around the room. We will actually have a management board. We'll do a joint meeting where we can brief everybody once we're fully seated. But thank you so much for your time. We appreciate it, and we are going to put you to work, so get ready.
I think the management board has opportunity to really implement and draw forward a lot of these concepts that I see us pulling together. I'm just extremely enthusiastic as we're able to approach this. I think we're going to do things. That's what I want, do things.
Yeah, we are going to do things.
I know that.
It's a very talented group.
We really do have an amazing group. Yeah. One point I do want to make, that this is a moving opportunity for the council and for the board. So once we seat these committees, that doesn't preclude you if you feel that we need expertise in an area or we've missed something that we should be considering, that we don't come back and make some additions along the way. But it's my hope that if we can move through today's agenda with the CAC and the STEM Advisory Committee and the Finance Committee, that when we do a briefing, in order to make this efficient, both financially and effectively, because we're going to need our attorney, Carolyn Ansi, to go through a number of legal issues and sunshine issues, that maybe we bring these committees first into an orientation. We do it all at once, and then everybody's aligned. And so we'll see where we are. Next item is the science, technology, engineering,
excuse
monitoring.
Excuse me just
yes.
a second. Don't we want to do the MOU?
I thought you did, but yeah, let's go ahead and do the MOU. I thought we did it combined, but let's do it as a separate, just so we're clear. So I'm requesting permission to execute that memorandum of understanding and submit it to National Park Service.
And this is a document that Ms. Ansi has participated in, or she's knowledgeable of?
Yes, she has.
I'll move that.
It's been moved. Is there
second,
please? It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion on this item? It's the memorandum of understanding between ourselves and Park Service. Is there any from public that wishes to make statement? Any wish to vote no on this item? It's accepted unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank
yes,
you.
Sir.
On the science, technology, engineering, and monitoring, on your slide, and I think it's up on top here, we had talked about three appointments for each of the board members. And I've been talking to the scientific community, and you have heard as well as I, there's some concern that how do you operate in the sunshine and make sure you have open dialogue amongst the science community. And over the course of the last couple of weeks, I want to at least put a proposal on the table that's a slight modification of what we talked about previously, and then you'll have two options to think about. So what we were talking about originally is three appointments where each of you would make a scientific or technical appointment individually. And as I began to structurally look at our community and the fact that we've got all these new players, Bethune-Cookman has hired some coastal people, Stetson has a brand new water institute, I began to think there may be a better method for this that gets us quicker and closer to our perfect dream team. And I wanted to suggest it as an option. On this slide is a incomplete, and it's something we may talk about if you want to move forward today, list of the organizations that are collecting data or driving real science along the Indian River Lagoon. And we're approaching, and there's some individuals who are retired. I don't know if Dr. John Windsor or others, you know, want to be formally in. So some of what I would call the old guard, Bob Vernstein, Dr. Vernstein. But if you look at this, the concept is this. If we appointed an agency, and let's use, you know, the first one, Bethune-Cookman, if we had one representative from each of those organizations, and that representative represented their entire organizational structure, then we've leveraged that network, number one, where we have all of the data players at the table, and number two, we kind of had a second tier of networking into those agencies and organizations where we can at least put some responsibility on the representatives to make sure we have good coverage. And I'll use University of Central Florida as a really good example. They're in the process of hiring five new coastal scientists as we speak in a cluster hire. They may be doing more. Stetson is doing the same thing. And so as I thought about the process, I thought, you know, we are going to wind up, if we do this individually, picking really good individuals, but maybe not having that breadth of disciplinary and interdisciplinary knowledge that we really need to address the complicated issues that we're talking about. And how do we best actually connect the network? And so it's at least my personal belief that this may be a better way. And so I wanted to suggest it to you for some discussion. And if you so choose to move in this direction, then my proposal is that you would, because you have the authority to appoint, that you would transfer that first phase to staff, that we would approach each of these organizations, find out who they want to designate as their representative, and then we would bring that back to you in our February meeting and see if there's any holes, and then we will have a very good representation. And it just so happens it has great geographic representation as well throughout the lagoon. And it seems to me a little bit more strategic process. But I wanted to leave that to you. I mean, whatever you tell us, we will move forward. But the organizations are way deeper today than they were, you know, when we did this in the first NEP.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir, please.
I think that's a stellar idea because I'm looking at this list and FIT and Eastern Florida State College are in my backyard, but I don't know the people there. And I know that there's an awful lot of great people there. So I would defer to people like John anyway. So I think this is an excellent idea.
Yes, ma'am.
What you described feels very inclusive, and I like that feeling. And I also observed that the grid for the STEM matches number-wise very closely to this shopping list, if you will, or this inclusive list. So I would support that recommendation.
Richard.
Yeah, I would just have one comment. I agree that looking at the list, I have very few knowledgeable people that I could pick from this list. I would like to be able to have, I do know one fellow that I'd love to have on that, and that's Brian LaPointe from Harbor Branch. So I would like to have a little bit of input to say, I'd like to see Dr. LaPointe there on this committee, if that's what.
Well, he certainly is qualified, and he may well be the choice, but what we're looking at is a little different, Richard, and, mm-hmm. and maybe you'd like to respond.
Well, I know Brian, and you're absolutely right. He needs to be at the table, and so this would be a discussion at Harbor Branch about who they want kind of inside the conference. And so there may be a decision, and this has come up with county staff as well, that once you become a committee member, you're bound by certain obligations under state law, under the sunshine. And so let's use Harbor Branch as an example. They may say, well, Brian is the perfect representative for Harbor Branch, and we are going to appoint Brian to represent us all. And he comes into the conference and formally is obligated to work with us under state law. But they may say, you know, Brian needs to be talking to the other nutrient folks and that we want them, you know, outside of the conference structure to allow for that dialogue, and whoever Harbor Branch represents would represent Brian and all those other scientists. And so this does not preclude, I'm going to put you on the spot if Brian's back there. I mean, Brian could still be at every single one of these meetings as a scientist who's participating in the debate and discussion that we will have with the CCNP revision. But it, what it does is it the network, the structure of this is, I think, more, not just more inclusive, but it will allow for some of the disciplines that we just never reached out to, like economics, some of the social sciences, those folks that haven't historically been at the table that are likely to be overlooked, because we will hit 24 of the major players if we did it individually, and we'll have giant holes in that connection. So that's, so I think, you know, if you all think Brian needs to be at the table and Harbor Branch thinks he's the perfect representative, we will let the agencies and organizations tell us who they want at the table. Exactly. And an alternate.
If you could just communicate our druthers, that would be great.
I think you just did.
Megan Davis is sitting back there taking notes, and she's heard us pretty loud and clear. I'm sure she'll appoint the right person.
Well, and I think one of the things, and you've hit upon it four or five times, and one of the things is we want the flexibility for all of these organizations. And to the compliance, we want to be in compliance. Of course, I don't want anybody to get in trouble, so we want to be in compliance with Sunshine. But we want the flexibility for the organizations. And I would see very strongly that your concept is extremely useful in accomplishing all of those things. But right, that's what we're asking everybody to have a little input on further. Any, Tom, did you wish, please?
Yeah, the... So you have others down here. Is this the entire list, or are you still trying to develop who the other groups would be? And along with that, are you including agencies like St. John's and DEP and, you know, scientists from that group?
I was actually looking for your direction a little bit. You know, there are tremendous data sets within the agencies. Those data sets are publicly available. I think some of those agencies may very well need and should sit on this committee, but I wanted some direction from you first on the concept, and then what we will do is, you know, look for the gaps. I'll give you a good example. Save the Manatee Club is interested in participating, and is that better in the CAC or over on the science side? And so that's a question I can ask some of these entities, and within the agency standpoint, clearly, we have agency representation on the governing or on the management board now, but there may be some key technical people that you feel from the agencies that need to be there. And so we will begin to work this next 4 weeks on this. And if you individually get back to me and say, let's look at so-and-so over at FMRI, you know, then we'll put that on the list, and we will bring the list as staff. We'll bring the list back to you. Because this number 24 is not written in stone. We need to make sure we have the right people at the right places with the right networking and knowledge sets. So I would like to see some agency participation, yes.
Okay. Debbie, we're glad you're here. Debbie Mayfield. So we're just delighted that you're here. What I see us doing, and I think Richard's helped us explore it, and Tom's dealt with it a little further, is what I see us doing is giving staff the flexibility to go in this path. And as Tom suggested, the agencies may well be some additional groups that we would like you to have that flexibility to talk to DEP, the various ones, and just see how they want to handle that arrangement. But that's what we're talking about.
Correct.
Further, of course, yes, sir, please.
I think it's a great idea, and I move approval.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Is there anyone from public that wishes to make comment? Any wish to vote no on this item? That's accepted unanimously.
Thank you. And just so you know the timeline, it's our hope and intent that we will have this list completed to your satisfaction by the February meeting. A perfect world, as long as we're on a roll with success in crazy time frames, I'm hoping we can have the Citizens Advisory Committee, the Finance Advisory Committee, and the STEM Advisory Committee all seated by March 1, if we can move that, you know, in an effective manner.
That would be great. Frank, I want to make sure that we encapsulated that motion. And either if you want to say or I'll summarize it, whichever you'd prefer.
The motion was to authorize the process that we've just presented to you for identifying members of the STEM AC and to proceed to implement that process with the goal to have the STEM AC identified for you, your review and approval by March 1st.
In addition, other groups that would fall under that consideration would be the agencies.
Yes, sir. Okay,
so we want to make sure. Well, you did a better job than I was going to do, so thank you very much.
They're good.
Yeah.
Probably good.
Yes, sir.
The next item is the Citizens Advisory Committee, and we want to suggest a process. You know, we know it's difficult, you know, with dealing with citizenry to kind of find both the influential people who have been here at the table before, but we think it's very important that the council and staff look beyond kind of the historic participation to new participation. And actually at all levels, I am personally, you know, interested and concerned to make sure we have good diversity on these. And so what we'd like to propose is that between now and the next meeting, and clearly before March, that we would look at the Citizens Advisory Council almost as a two-part process. That we have a number of citizens and especially stakeholder groups like fishing in the industries, commercial fishermen, recreational fishermen. And so we have stakeholders who have already expressed an interest to be at the table. And then we have individual citizens that we know, but there may be many out there that we haven't reached out to or they're just not aware. And so what we'd like to do with your authority and permission is to actually, and also your help, because we'll be looking to the counties, we'd like to do an advertisement for general citizen participation, very similar to what you do in the counties. And in fact, we'll be asking you from the counties if you could do it on your websites for us rather than doing general advertisement, that we would put the word out. We'll have a very simple application form. If you are an interested citizen and want to participate, you know, give us your name. You know, if you have a stakeholder affiliation, something very easy, we'll assemble that general pool and we'll assemble, you know, the stakeholder, you know, pool itself. And then among that pool, you can identify your three choices at each of the council seats. And so that gives the general population the ability to indicate an interest to serve. For those who are not chosen, my intent would be that staff is going to reach out and they're going to become a very effective citizen base, maybe not within the management structure itself, but we're not going to just let them disappear. We'll have contacts and emails and we'll engage them almost as a citizenry. And here's why I think this may be really effective. I have had a hard time getting my hands around and head around. How do you effectively engage citizens in a management conference discussion and a CCMP with five counties and the length of our counties and the diversity of our counties? And so I envision the Citizens Advisory Committee, which used to be the citizens would come to the NEP once or twice a year to have a meeting. I'm actually thinking the way this implements better is that we would have a meeting in Volusia. Those three Volusia Citizen Advisory Committee individuals will be kind of the local hosts. The whole committee will be invited. It will be under sunshine, but that we'll take these meetings kind of to the local area with very specific questions about how we move forward with the CCMP revisions. So we can kind of reach back into the local community, which allows those interested citizens who we might not have chosen for formal participation to engage in a very effective manner. And so at this point, we're just asking for permission to go ahead and do the advertisement. We're asking each of the municipalities to help us if you can, so we don't just do broad-based advertising, which I don't think is all that effective. And then we'll reach out and develop a pool, which will be quite large, and your decision will be to choose from within that pool.
I would imagine that each of us, counties and agencies, have a technique that we use when we have various openings for different boards or whatever we need individuals specifically that would volunteer. I imagine we have those techniques, and I'm suggesting that would be one of the things that we would do, would be offer our TV and our contacts, and this would be more specifically, I guess you would probably help design whatever the format is for the suggestion of the criteria. So that's, citizen involvement is going to make the difference whether we succeed or fail. So this is vital. This is absolutely vital. Comments, please.
Yeah, I would like to say that I like that idea, but unlike the previous category, I can think of probably five or six people right off the top of my head that I know have a real interest in the health of the lagoon. Fisher people, notice I didn't say fishermen, fisher people, boaters. So I could, and I'm sure some of the others probably do too. So what would you suggest, that we would just put their names in there with your, or?
I think that very much so. So, you know, if you look at that group as, I don't know if this is the right term to use, but you know, these are influentials who we've known because they're actively engaged and they're talking to you all as elected officials or agency heads. And so, you know, that becomes part of the pool. You will choose within that pool. So you may already have three people that you know you're sure are going to be on this list, but this process allows for us to identify that interested citizenry, and it gives you some opportunities, I think, to leave options down the line. So a good example, let's say we wind up with a half a dozen highly influential recreational fishers who, you know, maybe you appoint one, but that one now begins to network with those others who are interested. I mean, what we're talking about, and Commissioner Fielding is absolutely right, an NEP and a CCMP cannot work unless the citizens are behind it. And we can stand up here all day, you know, me as a PhD, and talk about how we would clean a lagoon, but if it's not embraced by the citizenry, we simply can't get there either through policy or funding. So I see this, you know, as the beginning of that outreach. Those individuals who are appointed to the CAC are going to be leaders within their community, building coalitions with us. So I see them almost as our ambassadors. So we're building a five-county super-regional coalition through the leadership of that CAC committee. And so whether they're on the committee or not is kind of an organizational issue, but we don't want to lose any engaged citizens in this process. So yes, you'd start with the ones you know that you may want to be there, but we'll take a look at the whole pool of interest in citizens, and then we'll see how to put that whole pool to work in different ways.
Just a second. Doug?
Yeah, I think this is brilliant thinking here, and I think this committee can, as we knock on doors for the foundation, I think you're going to find some talented men and women that live along here that have homes on the lagoon that are going to want to get engaged, that don't know we're even doing this yet. Chairmans of CEOs and men and women that run Ducks Unlimited to environmental organizations in Washington, they all live in Merritt Island, Jupiter Island, Johns Island, and as we grow, this committee can be that conduit for that kind of input. I think it's wonderful. I think this is heading the right direction.
Barbara,
not looking to add to Frank's workload, but if you're talking about now touching the grassroots of the community. Nothing works stronger without too much work than social media. And I'm thinking, I don't know if you have a Twitter account yet, but the Water Management District can retweet your announcement of interest to our followers, you know, numbering 10 or 11 or 12,000 right now, and that multiplier can work in your favor. I know you're still building, you know, an outreach and web and all those tools, but Twitter's easy, and that could be a spread the word vehicle for this, just to start pass the word around that you're, that people are interested, and here's the link to what to do about it.
Good. Thank you, ma'am. Richard.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I agree. I think that that's a great idea. And I think we all probably can think of many more than three people that we could put on this committee. But for those people that are interested, I think this whole thing has to be a trickle-up type process where, you know, it starts with the grassroots. And if everybody that we can identify from this that is interested in becoming part of that citizen advisory, we shouldn't lose their names or their electronic signatures and how to get a hold of them, because these are the people that are going to motivate everybody else and network and say, this is what's going on with the Lagoon. So whether we have them as a sitting member or, like for our boards, we always have an alternate. We put someone on a board, but we also have an alternate in case they can't show up. Maybe we can do that with some of these folks as well. I think it's a great idea.
Everybody okay?
Mr. Chair?
Yes, ma'am, please.
If I can, just real quickly, I just want to clarify one point. I think if you're going to have a process with an application that you advertise throughout your sites, that's great. I think if there are people that you identify that you know would be great folks to sit on the CAC, I think that they should be directed to the application, and they should fill out, as opposed to you submitting their names for them. It becomes a difficult thing if you've got a group of citizens who've filled out applications to get selected, and then there's another group where you all have brought them forward and told Dwayne to put them on the list. I just don't want there to be any, believe it or not, citizens committees can sometimes be controversial in how folks get appointed, and particularly if people ultimately get left off the bus. Again, you have the final approval. So what you're doing is telling folks, fill out this application. There's a slot available, many slots available, for folks to serve on the Citizens Advisory Committee, and then Dwayne will bring that list back to you, and you all will be choosing from them. But I think kind of coronating some people and then having some people have to fill out the application might be a little bit distasteful for folks. So I would just suggest that, and there could be concerns about whether that's appropriate or not.
Certainly an excellent observation, and I'm sure we will take that and follow through on that. Did you, any other comments from the board? We are going to vote on this item as to pass this authority to staff. Is there a motion to accomplish that, please? Yes,
so
ma'am.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Frank, you've got that motion, okay. Is there further discussion from board? Any discussion from the public?
A quick comment.
Yes, ma'am.
EPA does have a Twitter account, so what I can do is I can tweet about the CAC, the advertisement, or, you know, we can work on the language, how we want to say it, and then that can be a vehicle for other entities and organizations to retweet, because the council doesn't have a Twitter account at this stage, correct?
No, we don't. We weren't going to tweet anything until we actually had the NEP.
Yes, and that is today. So
I guess we're allowed to tweet now.
Yes, that's smart. That is smart. And then one other comment is that, you know, I encourage the council to think outside the box when looking at the potential members of the CAC, going beyond, like as Dwayne said, those traditional members that we know, not those should definitely have a right to be on there, but also, you know, I encourage you to try to think in your counties and in your communities, maybe those areas that haven't had a voice yet, maybe they are active or they need a voice, and maybe this could be one of those avenues where we could build some sustainable involvement for their community, maybe environmental justice areas, environmental justice areas, So just think about that. Think about your community and the big picture, I guess.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. That's very useful. Is there other discussion from the board and other public? And we have a motion. Any wish to vote no on that motion? That motion's accepted unanimously. Thank you.
And yes, Mr. Sir. Chairman, just as a point of clarification, while it's our hope that that would be done by March 1st, I think with the Citizen Advisory Committee, it's better to do it well than do it fast. And so we will move quickly, but we'll keep that process open. I mean, if we wound up with 10,000 interested citizens, Frank, I'm looking at you. The fact is that would be a beautiful problem to deal with. It really would. I don't think we'll see that number, but you never know. And so we will keep you individually informed as we're moving forward with this.
In accord with what Ms. Ansi has suggested, we do want to develop a form.
Yeah, we'll do a very simple form. We'll make it, you know, the same form in all five counties. And then depending on your ability to assist us in getting the word out, if we feel that we need to take an advertisement, we'll go ahead and do what we need to do, you know, from the office as well. But we want good coverage.
But I think each of the municipalities, the counties, the agencies, I think we've got enormous spread.
The coverage is going to be very effective.
Let's try that. Let's do try that. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
You're ready for it.
So the last one, which is the Finance Advisory Committee, is the easy one. And I just want to ask you all, in fact, I do have one recommendation already. The policy that we were looking at was that each of you would have an opportunity to place an individual who had some financial background on a financial or a finance advisory committee. They would work closely with staff. Now that we are real, now that we are spending money, it's our staff intent that per policy, we will be giving you financial reports every meeting from here on out. And so I'm going to ask you to think about this when you look at that individual appointment. Each of you has told me quite strongly your interest and intent in getting into the private sector and raising money. And so when you think about this committee, you know, you could bring an accountant on, you could bring a financier on, but don't forget somebody with financial background in major donor development, major donor cultivation. That is an important part of what you have instructed us to do. And so make that appointment. We'll bring those eight members back to you at our next meeting, and then we'll move that as a fairly simple, straightforward appointment.
There are qualifications or trainings or experience that allows one to be quite effective in some of this tax. What we're talking about is gifts and deferred taxation and some of those things, and I think, I don't, maybe it's beyond that, but some of that anyhow, as we would address how individuals might be able to develop a legacy for a particular project or something of that nature. If that's not what you're suggesting, then please.
No, that's exactly what I'm suggesting. But here's a process that may work. Before you talk to the individual that you're thinking about, why not, let's say over the next 2 weeks, so we're in advance of the next meeting, if you contact me, and if in fact three of you already said, I'm thinking about an accountant, you know, I can come back to you individually and say, you know what, maybe we need to broaden that a little bit, because it would be nice to have a breadth on this committee, but the fact is these are going to be individuals who you know. This is not something that works well in any other way than a straight appointment, I think, and it's only eight. If, in fact, we have areas that we don't have expertise, we can always come back and expand that group. So you are at, you know, if we wind up with eight individuals and we don't have somebody who is a deferred gift expert, then we can always add a deferred gift expert and go find somebody who wants to volunteer. But if we can get the management conference seated by March, even if we still have dynamic, adaptive interactions with those committees, then we can do the orientations, and then we can begin the heavy lift of work, starting with revision of the Comprehensive Conservation Management Plan, which will be every bit of a year, if not longer, in process. So.
We have comments or questions at this point? We okay? Do we have a motion to accept passing the authority to staff to be able to draft individuals or draft this concept into the working concept that was under our authority and give this to the staff? That's what you're
asking
for?
I think the action here is, you know, make your appointments, which is consistent with policy. That we'll talk, you know, I will be talking with each of you individually, you know, if you have questions about, you know, is this the right background? And so the action really is to make the appointment before the February Indian River Lagoon Council meeting at Harbor Branch, which, you know, I would say gives you 2 to 3 weeks to make those appointments.
Comments, questions from board? I don't see this as a vote item.
It may not be, because
well,
we've already talked
about
it.
Well, I'm certainly willing to ask for a
motion.
That's
at your discretion, sir.
Do we have, Frank, you have a proposal for a motion?
I think if the council members are individually going to be bringing back their appointees at the next meeting, I don't think we need a motion on this item.
No, I'm sorry, I should have asked Ms. Anderson too. Okay. Excuse me. That's how I would see it as well. So each of us and then those that are not present, we need to make sure they're notified as well so that we might be able to come back three. It doesn't seem like that ought to be a task, but that's a short time.
That is a short time.
So, all right.
And Mr. Chair, just to clarify, at the February board meeting, your bylaws do provide that you have to, as a board, approve all appointees. So even though you're going to be communicating with Dwayne, who you will be individually recommending for appointment, that full slate comes back to you for approval in February.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, sir, please.
All right, the next agenda item, I'm going to set it up. Frank will give you the full brief. You know, we have an RFP on the street for the 2016-2017 work plan. We're very pleased to say that we are kind of back on track. We have time-sensitive issues with those grants, and in fact, we have to present a work plan to EPA by June, and we are now pretty well caught up, and so we are getting lots of phone calls, but we do need to have a independent subcommittee of the management board to do the reviews of those proposals. So Frank, I'm going to go ahead and let you, you know, brief the council on kind of the process there. And where we go from here.
As far as the process, we envision having the project proposals come back to us by their deadline, which is the 22nd. What I'm going to be looking for today is a mechanism to establish a subcommittee of the management board to hear oral presentations from the proposals in the first week of February, to score those projects based on the proposals and the ranking sheet that was provided in the RFP, and then to have those final scored sheets available for review and process into the annual work plan that's due to EPA by June. So we would have proposals, scores, available by the March meeting, and then what we'll do is we'll, based on the amount of funding that we have in EPA funds and license plate funds and several different things, the priority issues for the council, the most important projects based on those priority issues, and then the scores of those projects in those different categories of priority issues, so that with that information you will be able to build a work plan. And so we'll be able to fund those projects down to a depth in those individual categories based on the amount of funds that we have. And then what we'll do is after your decision is made on the draft work plan projects, we'll go back to the proposal submitters, verify that they'll be able to accept that level of funding, that the project will still move forward, and then build the final draft work plan for your approval at the May meeting to go then to EPA by the June 1st deadline. So today, what I would ask is, with the assistance of council, determining how we can create a five-member subcommittee of the management group to meet in the first week of February to hear oral presentations and review the project proposals. Oh, let me add one more thing. It's a quick timeline, and we're working quick. I've been able to reach out to three members of the management board who have agreed to serve as reviewers and are able to, but I'd like to get up to five. I just ran out of time in trying to grab these folks.
So, Mr. Chairman, our understanding based on policy is, and Carolyn, you can, you know, confirm this, that, you know, technically by policy, this appointment would be yours. Because we are doing, you know, you've just appointed the management board. We're looking for a subcommittee of five. Frank and I talked, and, you know, it'd be nice to have some people who understand the system and some new faces and good geographic distribution. But the fact is that they have a very strict protocol of review. So we have a process for review. And so what we're asking is to allow staff to identify those five volunteers and move forward with the process. And does that comply with procedure?
So you're suggesting that the staff would do that after today, you're not asking the board to identify those individuals?
Correct.
Okay, because, you know, normally if we had the management board up and running already, they would have met and they could identify amongst themselves and take that formal action. The problem you have is that your bylaws do provide that you all, or someone that you've appointed, but someone who is a board member has to make that decision, and you'd be making it in the sunshine. And when you delegate that now to staff to go have that, basically take that action of appointing a committee that then has to apply these criteria, I do have some concerns. If you have the names, and maybe you don't have the names already, it would be better if the board could be presented the names of the five people and that those could be selected. But I think what I'm hearing from you is you only have three. Let me ask you this. Can you provide another list of four possible names to the board, and the board could then authorize you to go ahead and create a committee that includes the three you know are willing to serve and pick two of that remaining four to the degree they're willing to serve? Does that make sense? I think the board has to have their fingerprints on it to comply with both our policy, yeah, and make
and
sure
that
we don't
was
have
our
any
concern
sunshine
as
law
well.
Concerns.
Yeah. So here's a thought. We do have a lot of management board new nominees now in the audience. You have a list of three. I know at least one of those volunteers is in the audience. If we could identify here and now five volunteers, and then you would have that list, and we could move forward with that subcommittee.
Let me ask this as well, and Ms. Ancy probably would be the one, but Dwayne, you probably would have the input as well. Over the years, we've had a number of people that have been involved in this process, and so we've got training, we've got experience, we've got history. How might that fit in, or is that because they may well not be on the management? Maybe they are.
We actually have a number. Frank, go ahead and list the three who have volunteered, because we had that same conversation that, you know, reviewing proposals is not just challenging, it's time-consuming. No. And so having done it previously is a huge advantage to both process, but also the quality of the review. And so, Frank?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. Your comments are timely because all three of these have participated before on reviews for the IRL NEP. That's Kathy LaMartina, Marty Smithson, and Chris Ferraro. And all three were here earlier.
Well, we've got a good start. We've got a good start. So,
So, Mr. Chair, if you wanted to call for volunteers from those in the management board, we could complete that list today.
Very well. So let's see who's coming in. Oh, that's Kevin. Are there those that would wish?
Thank Bob Yulovich is raising his hand back there.
Are there those? Okay. Are there those that would wish to volunteer to participate in this selection committee? Barbara, Bob, Bill.
That's a good group.
We've got.
Mr. Chair, make your pick. I'm going to put it on you. Or you can put it on me, and I'll make the pick. We can do it by the first hands up.
Or put that on the short list.
We're going to ask the board how they would like to approach this. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate you helping us. Please, we got your name tag.
Sorry.
So you're slotted. You're slotted. Come get it.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
How about eeny, meeny, miny, moe? Because, you know, you've got some real good people volunteering.
Yeah, they're all really good. Isn't that a scientific methodology?
I believe it is, at the grade level I got to, anyway. I would recommend that we allow Dwayne to make the final decision. We can approve those three or four people that have volunteered.
Would it be earth-shattering if we had six?
Your call.
That's what I was going to.
Not at all. That would be fine. Thank you.
Okay.
So why don't we accept those three?
Six members.
It's been moved and seconded that the number selected be six, that the three individuals that were mentioned previously, then the three individuals that are currently here that volunteered. Those that volunteered, if you would stand up, make sure that we would get your names written down. Well, there's four. I didn't know she.
Thank you. And those who already volunteered, thank you all. We appreciate it.
Okay. Are we all right with six? Or
we are okay. And in fact, this is an important step. The timeline with EPA is a hard deadline. So we are on track, and we're looking really good now. So thank you.
Okay, let's have a motion then to accept those that have volunteered for this. Yes, sir.
Move approval.
Second.
Second.
Moved and seconded that those that have volunteered are accepted very willingly. Appreciate their, it is a lot of work, and so we appreciate what you're willing to undertake very much. Is there further discussion from board on this? Is there further discussion from public? Any wish to vote no on these individuals? That's accepted unanimously. Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I should have done that. Yeah. Thank you, Frank. Yes, sir.
Agenda item 8 is really a discussion item, but I wanted to start by just kind of setting the stage. And our hope from staff is that actually you have a good discussion and deliberation about this. We know that we've got a number of, you know, for lack of a better word, tactical compliance issues that we need to address over this next 12 months, which includes completing the management plan conference, which we've done quite a bit today, a begin revision of the CCMP, which we know is a long-term process that's driven both by science and citizens and each of the boards. We have management oversight now for 13 contracts. So as of yesterday, we just became the manager of 13 existing contracts, and they are in different levels of activity. So some we still need to execute to get them moving forward. Yesterday, we met with St. John's River Water Management District and had our first pre-negotiation conference with the contractor for the stormwater feasibility study. So we are going to be actively involved in that process with a goal of trying to get a final report done early enough so we're ready to give Drew Bartlett information that he needs in advance of next year's session. We have a work plan that needs to be created, from this proposal process by June and submitted it to the EPA. And we've got an interesting timeline that I was talking to Jennifer about, that we are due for a full evaluation. You know, basically, we will be evaluated by the EPA in 2017 as part of our regular program evaluation. That PE is a very rigorous analysis. We had some discussion last night. Is that going to be the 5 years, or is it going to be our first year? It really doesn't matter to us, but we want to know ahead of time so we can begin preparing the documentation. And so looking at just that portion of our workload as staff, and then thinking about our discussions individually and your collective discussions about wanting to move projects, wanting to raise money, looking at some policy issues, we thought this would be an appropriate time to have you give us some guidance as staff as to how do you want to move forward with that strategic side of this program? What do you think is the most important things we should be looking at over this next 12 months in this very first year of a national estuary program? And then we can start building that into a strategic action plan for staff and our engagement with you. And I want to lead into Commissioner Fielding. All of you have talked to me about your interest in septic policy in the state of Florida. We've got a stormwater feasibility study underway, and it just seems that there may be collective momentum that policy shift ought to be part of, you know, our strategy if, in fact, part of the goal is to affect change in state water policy as it relates to that. So I just wanted to turn this over to Chairman Fielding and you, and our hope is that you can give us some guidance. We're here to help the entire conference move forward, and we want a little clearer vision on where you think we ought to be a year from now and what your highest priorities are outside of those that are already on our plate, which are significant.
And I think we have probably more things than we're going to be able to juggle, but that's not the point. The point is that we have direction and that we have focus, and that as we move forward, then we would plan to accomplish these various things over a period. So I don't know that 12 months is going to allow us to, but we're going to get a good start. So on the septic sewer, that's something that we have gotten, we, Martin County, has gotten more closely involved in, because that's not the only source of pollution by any means into our waterways, but it is a source. And so if we're going to start addressing the various sources of pollution, then the septic, yes, sir?
Are we sure? They got enough copies.
Yeah, we got it. Then that is an important source. What I see, an approach, and that's what this outline addresses, but an approach is that we as individual municipalities or counties would determine priority. Where is the heaviest pollutant location? So we would determine priority, and the way that we've worked on that, and this isn't magic, so there's probably a lot of different ways to do it, but one of the ways that we've worked on that is to develop a schema that talks about the various evaluation criteria, and it's population density, it's whether there's potable water. And the significance there is what's the interaction between the water that's available for people to use and the groundwater that's being contaminated. The classification of the surface water that's nearby and what's happening to it and what should it be, or what's DEP said that it should be. And so we're trying to incorporate that. The proximity to the surface waters, whether it's in the floodplain, the groundwater table, a lot of you have been in Florida a long time, and you know sometimes the groundwater is very close And when that's the situation, septics don't, you might think they are, but they're really not functioning in the way we would want them. All they're taking is everything and putting it in the nearby water as quickly as it can. So that groundwater, the depth of the groundwater is a very important consideration. The soil types themselves, clay-type soils are difficult. They don't do, they don't help a whole lot with this absorption, and some of the other soils might be more useful. The surface water management systems, what have we as a county or municipality, what have we done? How are we trying to buffer and minimize the stormwater runoffs and trying to capture those, most people say nutrients, I call them contaminants, for a reason. I do that so that we don't get into the habit of thinking it might be good. So it's not good, those things that are in that water are contaminants. And how, what kind of stormwater system do we have to capture that? And then the nitrogen nitrate load contribution in the groundwater itself. And then what might be the most obvious is to verify the presence of human fecal source markers. And that would seem obvious if that's what's happening, that that's what we need to address. So these are the selection criteria, and then we weight those criteria. And I'm not suggesting that everybody just pick this up and say, okay, here's what we're gonna, here's, I'm not saying do this. What I am suggesting, though, here is a system that we have, that has been developed, has been put into place, and we, and as a result, there are areas that are then to, that have priority, that then are to be addressed for conversion of septic to sewer. So that's one aspect of it. Where are we going to do it? Another very important aspect of it is money. And the candidly, a reason that I'm encouraging each one of us to look at a system for our own particular responsibilities is because we each need to figure out how financially we're going to address it. I want to get as much help, as much grants as we can from anybody, from EPA, from DEP, from whomever, but we can't wait. That's what I'm really wanting us to realize. We can't just say, well, I don't have the money for it yet, so we can't wait. We really need to, I'm encouraging us strongly to develop a program and then develop a funding system for that program so that we get started. And once we get started, then it's my strong impression, once we get started, that we will then have a better opportunity to get some of these grants from either EPA or DEP, because then we have, we're doing stuff, and we're showing evidence that we have good faith. And so that's how I see us moving forward. Now, on our particular financing, and I have no idea how y'all, there is state money available for this septic sewer. For individuals, we would be able to get 15, 20, 25-year amortization at less than 1%. So I see that as an extremely attractive opportunity as we approach the overall project. Our objective, our goal, is to bring the per unit cost for the individual household down in the $10,000 range. That it costs more than that to do it, but we would be contributing, we, county, utility, we would be contributing monies to bring that average household cost down into the 10,000 range. So that's one user, that's the average folks like us, that's the average folks. So it'd be in the range. Now there will be individual households that's financially a burden. And as a result, we also are planning that we would have a pool of money that would be available to help, that would help meet those financial needs for individuals that are, this would be difficult for, and not just the capital, the annual capital, but there may be some difficulties for some in the monthly. And so we don't want to just assume that because this is something we want to do, that everybody is going to be able financially to bear it. So these are the concepts that I see us moving towards, is the projects themselves, and then how are we going to support the individuals and the citizens as we then move forward in these projects. So that, and appreciate Dwayne giving us the opportunity to talk about that, but you might have questions. I may or may not have answers, but.
Welcome, Councilman Daniels. How are you?
Thank you.
We were just talking about septic to sewer, and this is an open discussion. Staff had requested, you know, some guidance from the council about, you know, what do you think beyond what we have on our plate right now are the important topics for the next year? Mr. Chairman, you're talking about, you know, policy, and I know that Councilman Daniels was working with Volusia County looking at the water bill and potential amendments. And so if you would like to just give the council a quick brief on, you know, where Volusia is on this, because what I'm looking for from the staff side is if septic to sewer, if that is both a policy issue and also, let's say, a potential funding issue, if that is a high priority for you, you know, knowing that the comprehensive, conservation management plan is going to address it, but not in the timeline for action, then we can start to adjust our discussions. For example, maybe we do a workshop on septic and try to bring the five counties together in some, you know, unilateral vision for where this can and should go, both in policy and funding, and then we move it forward. We know that and Drew has mentioned on the record his intent on taking the stormwater feasibility study and moving that to some position for funding. And so, you know, you all have said, we want to turn dirt. I want you to let us know where you want to turn dirt so we can help you as staff and with our, you know, our management conference over the next 12 months, get us so we're still moving forward on those actionable high priority issues. And this one, just, I brought this one up mainly because you and I had talked about it, but each council person has mentioned septic to sewer is a big issue. And there are others, you know, out there, water retention issues. There's a number of issues that are hot issues that could be useful to us. And so Councilman Daniels, do you want to weigh in on this and just kind of give a brief on our briefing with Senator Simmons? Because that was very much a policy discussion.
Yes, it's really the most important issue in Volusia County. Septic tanks are really our big issue. We have a few others, but septic tanks is really the thing that we're most interested in. What we did was we met with Senator Simmons and wanted some changes to the water bill. There were some glitches, of course, in the bill that needed to be straightened out with regard to septic tanks, and we brought those up. And the other thing that we wanted to do is to put in the same protections for the Indian River Lagoon that bill had for the springs. And, you know, one of them was give the counties the option of prohibiting septic tanks in the area around the lagoons, just like they have the option to prohibit septic tanks around the springs if the bill passes. That sort of thing, and to require people to hook up. One of the problems you run into is if you can't require people to hook up to sewer lines, it's very uneconomic to run one. You can't run a sewer line and have people that you say that, well, I want to stay on my septic tank. That just doesn't work. You have to be able to spread it out among everybody who is adjacent to that line. So The other thing was, is if you're close to one of those water bodies, you have to hook up to the sewer line if it is there. It doesn't matter what the condition of your septic tank is. You know, we all know, I think it comes as a surprise to most people, but if their septic tank is functioning properly, it doesn't matter. It's still spewing out nitrogen, it's still spewing out phosphates, it's still polluting the water. They don't really understand that, and it's a bit of an education campaign that has to go along with it, so that they know that this is serious, that this is a problem. But right now, it is in Senator Simmons' bill, and we hope that it passes the legislature in the form that it's in. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Tom, please.
Sure. You know, I think this is a very timely, you know, issue to talk about. And one of the things that strikes me is that we can take action now, you know, on septic tanks and do that through our BMAP process. And I think it's one of these issues where, you know, where you have to identify where septic tanks are one of the major contributors to the area, as Commissioner Daniels mentioned, you know, and definitely in Volusia County, there it's a large issue. In other areas, it's not quite as big of an issue, where stormwater is more of an issue. And you really have to look at the geology and look at what the sources are, which is one of the things that we do very, you know, at a very fine detail in our BMAPs. I think discussion of the policy is a good thing to have. However, as we all know, this issue is one that not only affects, you know, the elected officials, it also affects the homeowners and their pocketbook, and it affects them, you know, quite a bit month to month. And so it is one that they speak out quite a bit about. And on the state level, you hear a lot of discussion about it. So I think policy, you've seen a step with the water bill as far as policy. There's still discussions that can be had, but that's going to be long term. You know, so there are things that we can do now. And you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, the focus, you know, the focus on doing things now. Where can we put projects? What can we do now? We have that ability. And, you know, I think we should take hold of that. What you've put together here for how Martin County is focusing your projects is a good thing, and one that we recommend, you know, in our BMAP process with every entity, try and figure out where's the biggest bang for the buck. And we can do that, you know, that currently there's funding available through the through DEP and through the water management districts. A lot of that focus is, and prioritization is based on whether they're part of a BMAP, part of a restoration project or not. And as you mentioned, there's loan opportunities. Again, that's focused on BMAPs. This year, we've requested, and the governor has supported that request, for additional dollars to go to restoration projects, specifically in BMAPs. There's a $37 million request from the governor. The department put in $25 million. The governor upped that, knowing that this is a big issue, that we have restoration dollars. And again, that's, you know, that's where we're focusing things. So I would really encourage you know, this group to look at, you know, what can we do now? I mean, that's why we, you know, formed, you know, this NEP. That's what our focus is. We talked about, you know, doing the stormwater, you know, project and getting that information so we can focus on the areas where spending money on stormwater, where it's appropriate and most needed, and we're spending money on septic tank, you know, abatement where it's most needed. And that process and those discussions, you know, can happen and will happen throughout the year as far part of our BMAPs. So just wanted to put that out there.
Good. Thank you, sir. Other, yes, sir, Richard.
Yes, Mr. Chair. I believe that Vero Beach is kind of leading the way in the STEP program, which we're going to be investigating here in Sebastian. And that is, instead of a gravity sewer program in areas where they're already built up, it's much less invasive to put a 2-inch line in and a grinder pump to siphon off the effluent of the septic tank and get that out of the drain field than you know, than doing the gravity drain. It's about half as costly as well. So if that's working for Vero Beach, and I believe it is, it's something that other communities probably would be interested in getting that information and going along with that program. The advantage to that is that instead of $20,000, you're looking at probably $9,000 or somewhere in there to hook up to the sewer. And I believe that for subdivisions or areas that are already built up, it makes a whole lot more sense to do something like that. The other advantage is when you have an event like we had in 2004 with hurricanes, and you have no power, the septic tank takes over. I mean, the drain field still works. The grinder pump doesn't pump it, but you don't have stuff backing up. So it's a kind of a win-win.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm. I know that we've been encouraged to follow up and look at what Vero is doing. So, and I've passed that along to others as well. Yes, sir.
Just a general comment. I think the two biggest items that we've got are to take the major inflows into the lagoon and park that water out west where we can, and to deal with septic tanks. The studies are in, they're clearly point to the, we need to remove them. Anybody in the Indian River Lagoon Basin who flushes a toilet, we got to remove those as soon as possible. But we can only, like eating an elephant, we only can go one bite at a time. And I agree with your process. We need to look at the most polluted and work back. I'll never forget when Henry Dean had me fly over Nettles Island before they went online at low tide. And that was such a graphic example of what we don't want in the lagoon, because I was in there along that stretch of that lagoon water skiing a lot. And when I saw that, I was fully engaged with whatever we need to do to rectify that situation. So I like your thinking of having a process of taking the most polluted and working our way back. We can only do what we can do with our resources, but we've got to do that. And it's a tough one because St. John's just offered free hookup to everybody in the Waikava Springs Basin, and only 60% of the people signed up because they didn't want to pay the $35 a year service fee after that. So it's a tough road, but you got to be tough on this. You got to tell people the facts. You got to move forward as aggressively as you can, because it has to be done. Anybody who flushes in the basin, they're contributing to the pollution of the lagoon.
Other comments, questions? So I would see us then, we as a board, I would encourage us strongly to support the concepts. I don't see how we as board would be able to focus on individual municipalities or individual counties. Rather, the verse is that the board would issue, if you choose to do this, would issue the general support for this type of a overall project, then those participants, our county participants, our municipal participants, would then come back with specifics about here's what we're going to do, here's the plan that we're going to take, and here's how we're going to finance it, and that as much as we can as a board, then give our support to help those state monies or federal monies that individual counties or municipalities are requesting, to help that or to encourage that to be done as well. I think regionally, that we would be able to attract to more substantially verify the overwhelming need for this type of a project, and would reinforce the request from the individual counties, municipalities. That's where I would see our function is more of what. See, I'm just sort of talking at the moment, so you guys, I need you guys to say what you think. But I would see us coming to say our focus, our concern is, just as Doug, as you've expressed, that this is a pervasive contributor of the contaminants. And so every member, every local government is, we encourage to support and take action on that. And then when they do, I think that's where we can come in and say, okay, we as a board, as a region, we support this activity. Jennifer, you and Tom are probably the ones that are, if you had anything you wish to say, I'm okay. Tom, yes, sir, please.
Dwayne, we have does staff have a list of projects, whether they're septic or stormwater or curtailing the inflows that we could start getting our hands around for 2016 and carve that out? Have you started that process?
We haven't started the process, but in talking to each of the counties, it's clear to me that there's some really interesting projects and policy decisions being made. But, you know, what's going on in Volusia may not be known down in Martin. And so one of the things, that's why I asked this general question, that, you know, part of an NEP, the power of an NEP is sharing best management practices, sharing information, sharing knowledge. And if we know that septic to sewer is a high, value proposition that you want to move forward as a council, we know that stormwater, we've got our feasibility study moving forward. We know that at least in Brevard County and a few other counties, muck dredging is a big issue. Then that gives us as staff some guidance as to how we might prioritize some of the issues, not only within the CCMP discussion, but the more tactical discussion of how do we position ourselves from here to next year's session, the 2016-2017, so we're ready for, early on in this system, we're ready for any policy recommendations or funding recommendations. And so when this session ends, we're ready to go with a pretty clear directive on where the Indian River Lagoon Council and the NEP, want to drive both funding projects and, in fact, maybe policy. So we're looking for general guidance at this point. We don't expect to solve the problems, but we don't want to stay tactical, and just administer paperwork. We want to make sure that all of your individual and collective messages to us have been, let's start working on this. Let's get some projects done. Let's move it forward. So we want to lose that strategic implementation phase as we're bringing the NEP and the CCMP online. So one of the things we could do, and I think it's a good idea, is maybe we start assembling, who's doing what as it relates to septic and sewer, just like Commissioner Fielding just did with his, and we can bring that back to you for some discussion as to where do we go next. Is it a policy issue or is it a straight up funding issue? And my guess is that we'll wind up having to do maybe some research or contract work to get numbers. But it does move the ball forward in a programmatic way, in a project way.
Well, what's going to, if I can just finish on that, please. What's going to be important to me in 2016, sooner rather than later, and that is that we have a suite of projects, things that we can point to, that we have the measurables around, the metrics around. I think in keeping this momentum going, we have to balance, the methodology and the policy with the actual, here are some things that we're doing it. I got to believe there's some low-hanging fruit, some chip shots out there that I'd like to see come forward and say, hey, none of them will solve all of the problems. We know that, but here's a good start, because that's going to be important, I know, certainly for our board in continuing the support and the momentum behind what we're doing here.
So, Kevin, to your point, do we have the information? I would say either yes, we have it, or we're gaining it. Right now we have the stormwater study that's going on that's going to inform us on that. Earlier I was talking with Chuck Jacoby about what we're doing with septic tanks, and I had some of these maps right here that has, where the septic tanks are for each one of the counties, where they're located. We would also overlay this, as Martin County has done, with some of the soil conditions and everything to prioritize various areas. these are the discussions we're going to be having early in 2016 as part of our IRL BMAPs and also the St. Lucie BMAPs. I know we're having this discussion also up in Mosquito Lagoon and up in Volusia County as well. So a lot of the information we have it in hand. You know, it's making sure we get that out to the counties and the utilities to be able to put together the plans of how are you attacking it and getting those projects identified so we can put those in the BMAPs and get them prioritized for funding. And that's what I see as the path forward.
Good, thanks. That's what we were trying to stimulate was the discussion about focus and right. about procedure. So that was very useful.
One last comment. I just had this flash of, I don't know what it is, brilliance, or I'm a dummy and I finally got it. But looking at, you know, over $300 million worth of legislative requests from the five counties and the breadth of those, the diversity of those projects, I mean, everything from parks and environmental. Imagine if we were in next session, next year, bringing a cohesive, strategic set of projects. You know, that were within, you know, baskets of management plan, action plan. So you've got a septic to sewer and you've got 20 or 30 projects. You may not get them all funded, but at least there is a strategic kind of long-term connection to those projects, which then establishes a long-term funding, at least expectation, and then we can start moving from year to year. So we'll continue this dialogue with you. Individually, and I'm thinking probably not at the next meeting because that's going to be a unique meeting at the Harbor Branch, at part of the Indian River Lagoon Symposium, but maybe we can put this into an action plan strategy so we actually have marching orders as to, you know, when are we going to get that information together? How do you develop a project? Who's going to do it? Maybe we have each of the counties and we empower staff to come back. And we can vet that through our, you know, management conference, but it does give us a very strategic, forward-looking process to get to those projects that fit both our current CCMP. Don't forget, we still have a CCMP that, and we have an Indian River Lagoon Act that actually was very specific about the reduction of pollutant loads, and so we are working well within policy and well within our own policies in the NEP as we're revising. So that guidance is very helpful.
Other comments from board? Dwayne, let me just ask you, please, is this something you want us to look at or not yet? You tell me, I don't know. What do you think? Let me pass some of those out.
I think we gave these at the last meeting.
We did.
The commissioner had given a listing of comprehensive lagoon restoration plan topics. It included, you know, what are the various sources of pollution, directing stormwater flows, looking at economic analysis of values, septic to sewer conversion projects, data gathering, you know, doing committees. The process that we just began with the management conference will address all of those. The importance of the discussion you just had is it gives Frank and I and future staff as we bring them on a bit clearer end game to what we want to focus on. And so, you know, is doing an economic analysis update important? I think it's critical. But is it urgent to a timeline to the 2016-2017 legislative process? Maybe not, but, you know, septic to sewer surely is. We know dredging is going to be an issue. We know that water farming is an issue, and it's going to be, you know, we have opportunities that are current, that are moving forward, and the more we can direct them with good science and good policy direction from this collaboration called a National Estuary Program, I think the more likely we will see advancement in both, you know, the improvements to and ultimately the restoration of the lagoon. So this is going to be a moving target. And so what I would like to do with your permission is, and this may be appropriate because I was going to bring this up in my comments. We have a unique opportunity at our next meeting because we are going to be at the Indian River Lagoon Symposium at Harbor Branch. Much of the audience will be a combination of citizens and scientists. And there'll be a lot of science discussion, you know, before that meeting. What if we spend some time at that next meeting, and I will do a brief, and I will engage Jennifer, you and your staff to help me on this, to give you a better guideline of that CCMP revision process? And because everything you have in here is part of that. And we have a CCMP in place that may not be as actionable as we want, but everything that you have here is moving forward with maybe the exception of the data gathering and library. And I would like to defer that discussion until we get a report from Harbor Branch from their workshop, because we just did a 2-day workshop on data, you know, and data archival issues, and put the CCMP in a good timeline process, because really that's the roadmap. I don't know if those of you in the audience, or I know some of you, I know Doug has, if you've ever been out in the open ocean sailing or doing oceanographic research, you don't leave port without a plan. Because once you get out there and you lose the horizon, the wind blows, the currents are different, you get a storm, you always blow off course. Or if you happen to see a whale, you're gonna go off course to check it. You'll be opportunistic. But the fact is, we need to have that plan in a timely manner, but not so fast as we minimize the power of the coalition and the consensus building that a good CCMP delivers. And so it is going to take a year to get there, but that doesn't mean that we can't take cherry pick those low-hanging fruit that Commissioner Powers mentioned, and we can cherry pick low-hanging fruit and move agenda items and move projects concurrently with doing this very heavy lift that's called a CCMP revision. And so I urge all of us to be adaptive and responsive and take opportunity, especially as funding, you know, happens. And so I see this as part of that larger CCMP dialogue.
To Duane's point, I've been visiting legislators from Steve Crisafulli to Joe Negron to Deb Mayfield, all the leadership here in the East Coast about citrus funding for our research needs for greening. All of them said, how about the lagoon? How's that going? I mean, we have got the attention of the legislature and the support of it. They want this to succeed, so we need to use that. And we've got the leadership, and one of them's right here, and Debbie, we've got some great leaders to help us do that. And they want to do that. So that's we gotta seize that moment, we gotta seize that momentum and take it and move it down the field.
I want to make sure, but I think staff feels very comfortable that they have been given not just the authorization, but the strong encouragement to be calling on the legislators and to be presenting our case. And so whether yourself or Ms. Daniels, whomever, or when you're going on your own, whomever, I think has been expressed, this is a vital time for us to be making our awareness more evident to others, and so I appreciate that very much. Thank you. One thing that was tangentially mentioned, DEO and the two regional planning councils are involved, and I thought that there were some recent information about this analysis, that they are involved in doing a financial analysis, and I think there was some information about some things that they found that's going to help make this a more in-depth process, but be probably accomplished more quickly than we had thought. So when we get to that point, we'll ask Barbara if she will probably ask her. Yes, sir.
It's maybe a good point for that discussion. I did talk just before the holiday with Barbara and her staff, and maybe this would be a good time to have an update, because we are almost to the end of the agenda. We've got some additional, you know, staff comments that we're going to bring to the table. But even though we were a quick meeting today, you have just made a phenomenal next step to having a management conference, and of course, having the NEP now formally and legally in our control allows me now to go to legislators both in Washington and Tallahassee and speak with one voice for you representing the NEP. So I have two scheduled visits in February. I'm trying to figure out how January's. We have a number of things we have to do in January. I know that Barbara Ross is going to show you during staff, you know, the update to the legislative ask. So this might be a good time to have Barbara give you an update on that economic study.
If you wish, certainly. Yes, ma'am. Are you, would you like to do that to some degree?
Well, I can tell you a little bit. You want me to step up?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Hugh Harling is here with the Central Regional Planning Council as well, and they actually have the contract for the study. And they are subcontracting with the Treasure Coast Regional Planning Council, and Mike Busha, the executive director, has been in charge of that valuation portion of it. It's $100,000 that DEO has given them this year for the kind of second year in a row that they've done Indian River Lagoon work. Mike has been working with us to develop the methodology. I believe that Dwayne DeFries has been identified as a subject matter expert, as well as other agency and private sector people, whoever can offer information. We have a lot of the labor market statistics in our building. They supply the information to the Census Bureau, the federal census. It actually comes out of our building, and we have George Foster, who is the person that we're working with to help provide a lot of the labor market statistics data and guide the Regional Planning Council in the use of that data. So that source is really amazing. What happened early on in the study is we had looked at the 207, or I guess 2008, Water Management District work that was done. A lot of that was done with a survey type work where people went out and talked to visitors and other people in the region. And for the funding that was available, that would have been way too intensive for the Regional Planning Council to be able to handle in a short amount of time. Their deliverable is due at the end of May, complete report. So one of the things that Dwayne sent us was the Ocean Alliance coastal study that did evaluation of the statewide oceans, coastal industries, and a cluster analysis. And when we looked at that, it really fit, and this is what we talked about at our discussion a couple of weeks ago, it really fit so well with the data that we have, hardcore data, not surveys. I mean, we're going to base this on actual industry data and jobs, and I think it's something that'll really catch the legislature's eye. So hopefully we'll be coming up with something like that for you with that part of it. There's another half, which is the cluster analysis, and I think that hopefully we can maybe look at doing some work on that in the future.
Thank you, ma'am. There are questions, please? Questions? No. We're just very appreciative. Yes, sir.
Has the council seen that Florida Ocean Alliance document by any chance? I will email you each PDF. The startling aspect of that, and it was done in 2013, but it was 2010, 2011 data, is the total economic value of the ocean and coastal economic cluster in Florida exceeded $580 billion a year. That's ports, tourism, research centers, and so it is a big, big number. And I suspect when we look at a comprehensive economic analysis of the Indian River Lagoon, that the number that we had previously, you know, is going to be very conservative to what true economic value is. And I think that was, what, at $6.3 billion? I forget that number from the 2008. What was it? $4.7
billion. Yes, sir.
Fishermen spend money. I was just at Bass Pro yesterday, and that's the only place I've ever seen grown men push a cart with a smile on their face.
Other comments? Yes, sir. I think we're down to nine. We're down to nine staff reports.
Okay, I'm up first. The first thing I want to do is to add my thank you to the City of Sebastian and your staff. You have been not just gracious hosts, but incredibly helpful. Your staff, you know, setting up the meeting, you've been available to us, so we really do appreciate deeply all that you've done for us. If you get a chance after the meeting, our offices are just down in the old 1926 school building, and they're beautiful, and they were at the exact right price of zero. And so we're really happy to be here. So, Mr. Mayor,
you drive a hard
you
bargain.
And your staff. Also, one of the things that there are a lot of speaking engagements coming up. I want to offer my services again. I will be giving a presentation to the Governing Board of St. John's in February. I think I probably have 15 or 18 engagements in the next 90 days. But I will be in Tallahassee at least for 7 or 8 days, and I'll let you know those dates if any of you are up there during the time. I'll be up there for Oceans Day, and I'll be up there for CareerSource Florida board meetings talking about the economy. And then we are, both Frank and I, will be going up to Washington, D.C. for a mandatory Association of National Estuary Programs and NEP meeting, which happens each year. And so we will let you know if there's places you want us to stop and do some information release, let us know. But particularly if you're walking the hallways at those same times, let's get together and we can do some of that together. We do have a lobbyist with the Association of National Estuaries. And so the good news as of the holiday was that the House and Senate are very close on their funding for the EPA NEP program. They are so close that it looks like it's a done deal. They have to go to conference, and so we're expecting maybe sometime this month or early first quarter that 2016-2017 year, right? Or is it 17-18 year will be funded at the same level that it is today. So it would be $600,000 per NEP. And that's all that I have other than Happy New Year, and we look forward to a very active 2016.
Are there questions for Mr. Riggs? Frank, what I think would be useful, Dwayne gave us some calendar kind of stuff of when he's going, is let's put that and send that out so that we, because I couldn't process all that while he was saying it.
I'll follow up and send that
please,
out.
Please. So you're okay, Ms. Ansi, you had things you'd like to add? Okay. All right, we have individual council members. Let's start. That's okay. Let's just start it.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to tag on to your vision for moving forward and expressing my desire that we do as much as we can this coming year in the way of putting those funds that are flowing into the organization to use in projects, in addition to the federal funds and the license plates funds. We also, each one of us, are funding to a certain extent this organization. I understand that the DEP is putting the $250,000 into the study, which is great. That's something that we really need, but the $500,000 from each water management district, the $50,000 from each one of us, I think that from a standpoint of looking back over the year and what we've done, if we fast forward a year from now, I think it'll be important that a good percentage of those funds are in new projects. Just my way of thinking, I think that's something we need to do. is not only fund, not only do projects with the federal money and the license plate money, but to a certain extent, whatever we have left over, put that into a good amount of projects as well. Hopefully, we'll get the same amount of funding next year from the water management districts, the EPA. And going forward, we can get private monies flowing into the organization. But anyway, that's my hope.
I think we share that hope.
Okay.
We share that hope.
Mr. Chairman, on Tuesday, the 12th, the St. John's Governing Board is going to look at a dispersed water storage project here in Indian River County at funding two sites. And there, if you went out with a blank map and said, I would love to grab these two sites to help the Lagoon and the St. Sebastian River, you couldn't pick better sites. For those of you who know this, the headwaters of the St. Sebastian River right around the high school, that was citrus groves for years and years, for decades. Well, that landowner is willing to go into a dispersed water program with the St. John's right where the very beginning of the little tiny channel starts. That whole area, we can create a large, massive marsh area to clean that water up before it even gets to the St. Sebastian River. That landowner has approached the district, along with a second landowner out on the end of the C-54, 1,600 acre site immediately adjacent to the upper St. John's Basin, and it straddles also the C-54. It's a site that could even take in all of the Fellsmere drainage that's on septic. It's just, you couldn't pick a better addition to the upper St. John's Basin to do more good to the C-54. The old Fellsmere Canal, which is right next to the C-54 that currently drains to the lagoon, he can take that water in, and I know Bill Kerr knows as well. So we've got two phenomenal sites that are up in front of the St. John's Governing Board for their approval to fund for dispersed water storage. Dr. Shortell would like to enter into a contract to the two landowners. I don't know for sure, but I'm pretty sure our governing board is going to see their way through to fund this. But it sure would help to have the support of this council. Again, I know this is short notice. I just got the projects on my iPad from the district 2 days ago or 3 days ago. You know how things go, Kevin. It's I'm pushing Dr. Shortell and the staff up there to get this going as soon as possible. The alternative around the St. Sebastian area is rooftops, as we know, and to grab this property while it's available and put 3 feet of water on it in a marsh, and out in the St. John's, 1,600 acres of marsh, additional marsh, cleaning the Fellsmere area water. It's a no-brainer. It's just one of those, it's two of those sites that are just magnificent, and I'm really pleased that we're moving quickly to get this done, and I would love to have the support of this council if possible.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and second that the council give its support to St. John's Water Management District for this is a conservation easements?
It's a 10-year lease, just like what they do in South Florida, what they do with Calkins, which is actually outperforming what they thought it would do on the C-44 canal. This is very similar. It's probably, I mean, you couldn't plumb pick it. It's as good as Calkins or better. I hate to say better to my South Florida neighbor here.
That this motion that's been moved and seconded, that the council would give support to the 10-year conservation easement on these two properties?
Yes, sir.
So that's the motion that's been made. Yes, sir, you have comments?
I'm in full support. I've known you and worked with you in many capacities over many years, and you've never brought a bad one forward, so I'm all in.
Thank you.
Other comments? Before we vote, does public have any comment? This item has been presented. Is there any that wish to vote no? That's accepted unanimously. Thank you, sir.
One more thing. Yes, sir. In addition to that, as you all know, I've been promoting water farming on a large scale. Last year, the legislature, thanks to, again, to legislators like Debbie and Steve Crisafulli Negron, we got to the governor with a request. I think it ended up being about $33 million. The governor at the last minute vetoed that for dispersed water storage. We're back at asking for $50 million. I have been working closer with the governor's staff. They are very involved with this. I'm meeting with them again on the 21st at the urging of Joe Negron and Steve Crisafulli and all the legislators to make sure the governor understands how beneficial it is to the lagoon that we park water in the western sections of all these counties and allow it to be a future water supply source or more water to the St. John's or South Florida districts. And so we're meeting up there, and I just wanted the council to know that I'm gonna walk in with DEP, the St. John's Water Management District. I've extended invitation to Jeff Sumner and Pete at South Florida. And other people are going to join us in asking the governor's staff to this year support the $50 million request so that we can get dispersed storage as a major component of our future water supply.
That's good.
Just an update.
That's good. Frank and Duane, let me just make sure on this approval that we received to implement that approval, I think we would send a letter. We need to do something.
Doug, what do you think would be best? I mean, I can change my schedule. I have one appointment I can change that day, and I can, you know, bring that unanimous support as a public comment, or would it be better to have it as a written letter?
Either one. I think nothing beats being there in person. I know you're busy. If there's a staff member that could do that.
I can do that.
I know you're taxed to death. You've got more on your plate than you could shake a stick at.
I'll get up to Palatka. I'll get more business done.
It's a long ride, believe me.
Than just giving a 30-second presentation. So if that's the most powerful and that's what you want, we will be there.
Yeah, whatever works best for your schedule.
I will schedule it.
That's a long ride up and back, 6 hours from here. So
don't worry.
That's a tough grind. My car does it automatically now.
We might have stationary or not yet?
Yes,
no,
we do.
I mean, because
we create it as we go, but we do have stationary.
No, it's okay. All right. So was that part of the motion that we would draft a letter of support? Is that acceptable? Is that part of the motion? That's part of the motion, Frank. That's part of the motion. Does anyone differ with that? That's part of the motion. And we did ask public, and we did ask public. Yes. Okay. That's fair. Yes, sir.
What Doug just brought up, I think, brings up, one of the critical things we need to be doing. A lot of our function is going to be political. It's going to be talking to legislators and members of the various water management districts to move these things along and make sure that they understand that we support them and that behind us there are people, a good number of people, who support those things also. If what you could do is to get out talking points to us, member of the St. John's River Water Management District from my area is a good friend of mine. I would be happy to sit down and talk to her about that. Number of legislators in my area, I would be happy to talk to them about anything that comes up that anyone on this board that this board supports. You know, I don't care what county it's in, I will be happy to sit down and talk to them about making that sort of thing happen. And if we band together and support each other's projects and really try to push this thing and really try to make it work, we can begin to make some fundamental differences. We can begin to elevate these issues to the top of the food chain in Tallahassee, which is really what we need to do. You know, both with the water management districts, with Tallahassee, with the funding, let people know that this is significant. And get as much publicity as we can to, you know, build support in the communities, let them know how important it is. You know, lots of times when you're dealing with people on septic tanks, because I've had that experience, what they don't understand is the damage that their septic tanks do. They just don't understand it. You know, they're told by the guy that put it in, it's working perfectly. They think that means there is no problem. They need to understand that that is just not the case.
Absolutely.
So we've got an education and a political role to play up here, but we all need to know what those issues are and what specific legislators are important to make it happen. And if there are some of those that we can reach out and touch, we all should do it in support of each other. Thank you.
Ms. Hansey, I'm trying to think through this thing here, and so you make sure that I see if I have. So what I think we would want to do is authorize staff then to gather information that would be applicable for various projects and legislators, and that they could, then we would authorize staff to also disseminate that information. You tell me how.
What you're honing in on is what obviously I was sitting here wringing my hands over, is we've got to be very careful, particularly to the degree these are issues, as we just had, where the board has taken action on supporting something as a board. We can't have individual board members providing talking points to other board members or information that would then arguably be construed as a discussion outside of Sunshine. So to the degree that there are projects that you all want information on, I would just encourage you to use staff to gather that information and that data, bring it back to you, and obviously to the degree you want to, as a board, take a position as you just did on an item that is being pushed forward, you just do it in a public meeting and you'll have no problem.
Well, I knew that. What I was... do you see that it would be improper for staff to disseminate whatever they gathered to, well, tell me, please.
No, the staff can disseminate information to you. What staff can't do is have one board member provide information and say, okay, now I want you to give this to all the other board members and let them know that there's a meeting on this day and let them know that we need them to say this or say that. Now you're using staff as a conduit to communicate with other board members, and you have to avoid that.
I was trying to avoid that. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Keep us out of trouble. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dwayne, I thought it was a really good discussion. I appreciate you bringing it forward. I think you have a good handle on balancing a robust process with the actionable items that we're all looking for in this coming year. So I think it's important to Commissioner Daniels' point about, how we as a group move forward. I know for me, it's very important having things to point to in terms of metrics and measurables. We're 16 counties, South Florida Water Management District, and only two of them are on the lagoon. So, I've got to have things to take back to them that keep them, my colleagues on the board and the agency, fired up for what we're doing. I have all the confidence in the world that we're doing it, but it's to that balance of process and action items. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Tom.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's been about 7 or 8 months since I've been to one of these meetings, and I've been through the whole reorganization. It's amazing that we're here. You know, today's a watershed day. I know we've had a couple of those, and it's just congratulations not only to this group but to staff and everybody who brought this together. So you really deserve a lot of kudos for that. So thank you very much. I know that we've talked a lot about, what can we do now? And I think that's always been what this NEP has been about. What can we do? What can we do to protect and restore the lagoon? And so I just encourage everybody to keep that in mind. I like, focusing on projects, what can we put in place, getting those in line, and having those out there. I know one of the things, Dwayne, you mentioned that the next meeting's at Harbor Branch, and that's part of the estuary day. There's going to be lots of science about that point. I would like to put on, get on the agenda an update on the Indian River Lagoon Protection Initiative that the Water Management District has been doing. That was a multi-year study at looking at what the causes were, you know, for the superbloom. And I know that they're not complete with that study yet, but I know that they're, you know, in the midst of it. So there's probably some lessons learned that we already have, and there's information that's going to be coming out, not only to the Science Committee, but to ourselves here in the coming year. So I'd like to get an update on that. I think that would be very appropriate at that time. Thank you all for your efforts.
That request is acceptable to the board?
Yep.
Please. Yes. I see no contraries. Please. Yes, sir. Kirk.
I would just like to reiterate that I think it's a great idea that to have the counties working together, because I can tell you that Debbie and her cohorts, it's a much lighter load if she has four other county representatives and senators lifting and pulling in the same direction than if she's up there by herself. So I think it's important that that be stressed, that we work together as counties. And I think I can think of no better issue than the septic tank issue.
Yep. That's right. Good. Thank you, sir. I'm going to ask public. You had something, please.
Mr. Chairman, we have one other board report. At our last meeting, Barbara Ross was volunteered by Drew to help us out with the legislative piece, and she has a draft. So this
let's see.
Overhead works. I don't know. Is there a trick on that one?
Did that overhead work?
Yeah. Yep. Something.
Where am I looking? Oh.
You're cooking.
The content that Dwayne put together started like this, and he's a great scientist and he's a great leader, and it ended up like this, which I have copies for each of you. I do have the council members' names and a map on the back, but this is a one-page leave behind designed to, first and foremost, be a tool for legislative outreach, our priorities, who we are. We all know we exist, but we have to introduce ourselves outside this room. And I think this is a great tool for that, as well as any public outreach and communication of this, of, you know, even for the Citizens Committee, who we are and why are we here. I think this is the right tool. I'll have a copy for each of you. If in the next week or two you would give any content changes through Dwayne and our graphic artist, will bring it on home, and then we can email this around. You can use the document. You can print 10,000 copies and hand them out and put it to good use. So,
if she would recognize this is a draft, I would suggest that Representative Mayfield be allowed to, please.
And Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I just want to go on the record. Barbara, thank you so much. We appreciate that support.
Yeah, that was quick. That was quick. Thank you, ma'am. So if there's no other, you have anything else? Anything else? Then we do have public that would, if you do come to the podium, please. And we will need a, I don't know if y'all have them here, but we'll need a one of the speaker cards or fill outs. Please, yeah, state your name, please, sir.
Sure. My name is Graham Cox. I live here in Sebastian at 1213 George Street. A couple of things I want to say. First of thanks to Mayor Gilmore for making sure that Indian River County and Sebastian is included in this discussion. I really appreciate that, Mr. Mayor. I'm glad that it costs you nothing for the office space. That's a wonderful bonus. I want to go back, if I can, to the discussion of the Citizen Advisory Committee. And I say what I'm going to say right now without insulting anybody, but we're a sort of aged white room here. And the council referred earlier to the need to make sure that the Citizen Advisory Group is representative. It includes voices that have not been heard on a regular basis, if not before. Pelican Island Audubon Society, which I serve on the board, has an advocacy program with young people. I'm represented here, Christine Beck, from the Outdoor Center, and the Environmental Learning Center is also here too. we're doing this work for young people. We're doing this work for the next generation. So if there's a way that we can take advantage of what we're already doing with after-school programs, summer programs for young people, we're trying to make sure that they understand the science of the lagoon and in due course to become advocates for the lagoon. So if there's a way that we can essentially form a young people's cadre to provide advice and be included in the way the council is operating, that would be a really, I think, a good step forward. And the second thing I want to say when it comes to inclusion is I spend quite a bit of my time with the folks in Gifford, the Gifford Youth Center, and with the folks in Fellsmere on quality of life issues. We've talked about the lagoon as a sort of a very narrow thing, but in fact, the lagoon watershed includes a lot of folks and a lot of land to the west of the lagoon. I want to be sure that we have representation. Commissioner Bonique has already mentioned water dispersal areas to the west of the county. Those affect people who live out there. So we've got to make sure that the folks who do live in the western end of the system are included in the discussions about the lagoon and somehow brought in the discussions about the on the citizen advisory group, the technical, any way we can, because we've got to include folks. We've got to include them and so they understand how they're impacting, how they impact the lagoon. And that's all I want to say. I don't want to keep you from
lunch. Very much appreciate your observations.
Thank you, sir.
We'll incorporate those. Thank you, sir. Is there any other from public that would wish to make comment? Any other public? I see none. We're fixing to adjourn. All right. Let's adjourn. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.